But it'd be like, I'm JT, I'm Russell, I'm Jamie, and we are the, I said, uncanny OC-men.
OC-men.
Do we say it together?
And we are the uncanny
OC-men. Uncanny.
Do we not want to do that? I just put that in there because it's like X-Men thing. Welcome to the OC-Men, the all-new podcast where every week my two friends and I watch an episode of the mid-2000s primetime team dramedy, The OC, and discuss what we just watched. I'm JT.
I'm Russell. Hey.
And I'm Jamie.
And we are the uncanny OC-Men.
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 It's a hard men there. Our goal for this podcast is to figure out just why I love this damn show so much and see how two guys completely new to the series react to each episode in depth. Today's episode was the pilot from season one, obviously the origin story of the thing, the mythos, the beginning, the Phil Collins of episodes, as it were. Before we jump into it, though, I want to discuss the origin story of the show itself, the creator and its conception, its casting, all that sort of thing. So what you need to know about the OC is that was created by Josh Schwartz. And I'm getting this information from Alan Sepinwall's interview of the creator, Josh Schwartz, 10 years after the fact for the website hitfix.com. So the OC was a Fox Network primetime hour-long drama comedy. Its pilot aired on August 5th, 2003. It was created by the 26-year-old rookie television writer Josh Schwartz.
Yeah, 26. Shit.
That's what I was thinking. So in 2003, Jamie, would you have been 26 years old?
No, I was 23, but thank you.
Scratch out all my notes for these jokes. So his story is kind of a Sandy Cohen-esque story. So if you've seen the first episode, if you understand what we're talking about, his story is kind of that of the father of Seth. He is a Jewish kid that moved from the East Coast to the West Coast to go to college. Okay. He went to USC film school. All right. So just like Seth's father, Sandy Cohen, moves from the East to the West. He has the same type of story there. Once in California, Schwartz and graduates from college, Schwartz meets with McGee's company to pitch a show. He's a first-time writer. He hasn't really gotten a show yet. He hasn't got a pilot picked up yet. So he meets with MKG. That's Charlotte Hornets small forward MKG when he was 10 years old with McGee's company to pitch a show. And McGee is now finishing up Charlie's Angels 2 at this point, all right?
Mm-hmm.
Full Throttle.
Full Throttle is the subtitle of that. Once he hooks up with McGee, Schwartz meets, in the best way, he meets Stephanie Savage. And her collaboration with Schwartz is important because she's familiar and a big fan of teen dramas like 90210, to which the OC is somewhat reacting. McGee is going to be the producer of the show, and he's planned to be the director of the pilot episode, which never actually happens because he has to do reshoots for Charlie's Angels.
Full Throttle.
All right, so
Full Throttle colon.
That's the origin story of the show itself. The next thing we're going to move on to is characters and casting. What do you guys think about this origin story? Does it seem interesting to you at all?
Well, I will say, just to your point, not to derail it too
please
quickly.
Please derail it.
But well, because I read that McGee was supposed to direct it, but that Doug Liman directed it instead, and that dude's got crazy action movie credits, which was...
So is McGee at that point. Apparently, his original idea for a show is he wanted it set in the OC where he's from. McGee's from the OC, or from Orange County. I suppose people from OC call it OC, not the OC. But yeah, apparently he had an idea for kind of an action-y, Charlie's Angel-y type show, but then Josh Schwartz and Steffi Savage kind of pushed him towards something more like the OC than that. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah, I guess I had read something about like a 21 Jump Street almost kind of style. But I like that they still kept the action because I think Doug Liman, I mean, he kept the whole thing moving. But he's done like Born Identity and like Edge of Tomorrow and that Mr. and Mrs. Smith with Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie. So I like that it was like, it just sort of, fun teen drama, but you get like crazy action director to do it.
I feel like that explains some of the handheld shots there, because some scenes open like staring at a wall and then we'll just move to the right and then all of a sudden Marissa's mom's there, and it's just as it moves around the scene there's a lot of movement from that, which makes sense then that it's from an action person.
And think of the first episode's pacing just in general. It's just amount of information that gets across really fast, the amount of different scenes, the amount of different character interactions, and again, just the quickness of the plot. I mean, it's a character-heavy show, and it's definitely a character show, but this first episode is plot, 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 plot. Okay. There's a new twist. There's a new subplot. There's a new hint at something coming every few minutes on the show.
And I think the technique to doing a good pilot where you're trying to get across so much information and explain so many relationships at the same time without feeling like you're just doing nothing but exposition is... it's almost like a completely different art compared to just regular television writing. The fact that you can be like, well, you know that they used to date and, oh, well, I have a crush on this person and this and all of the different things that weave together without it just feeling ham-fisted and over the top. I thought that's what I was most impressed with.
I would say I feel like the pilot was both successful and unsuccessful on the exposition front because I feel like it was definitely loaded with that kind of stuff. Uh-huh. Like, hey, this is your job. Hey, this is your history as a criminal, Ryan. Hey, this is the history of the OC. So you've got a lot of that just kind of shoehorned in there. But I do think it was a successful one because it kind of just flowed past you. It didn't seem so contrived that it wouldn't have made sense to say these things. Because, again, you have that tactic you've seen in lots of movies of the outsider being kind of the avatar for the audience, coming into the strange situation so you get to learn about it with him because they're obviously going to explain it to him mm-hmm. or they would not say explain it to Seth or they wouldn't explain it to a character that's inside the situation. Someone coming from outside, and obviously he needs to be explained things. So.
Absolutely.
It's a tactic used. So you guys mind if we move on to casting, the original casting and yeah. kind of the concept of characters? Okay, mm-hmm. So some interesting stuff here. So if Seth is kind of modeled after his father, is kind of modeled after Schwartz himself.
Wait, so both Sandy and Seth are modeled after Josh Schwartz.
I would say so, okay. Yeah. So his thinking for Ryan would be that outsider avatar, that outsider character that the audience could identify with and could see themselves as coming into the situation fresh and not knowing as much, and as well as he kind of represents in the extremity the kind of overarching theme of the OC, which is that even everyone feels like an outsider in some way. No one feels completely comfortable in the situation. Even if it seems like they're a part of it, they still feel like they're a part of they're outside of the group, the kind of imposter syndrome that you've heard about.
Okay.
Right. So he kind of represents the extreme of that. Most of the characters, especially the main characters in the OC, in some way feel like they're a part, that they're a part of the situation, but they're also somewhat outside of it. They're not quite accepted. So mm-hmm. he's a kind of extreme example of that. That was the thinking for Ryan. And the other part of Ryan was to have Seth as, again, if you think of Schwartz as Seth, writing the best friend he always wanted. So he's this dorky, unlikable kid that's not having a good experience in high school. So he writes what he says in this interview as the coolest brother imaginable when he wakes up one morning, the coolest brother imaginable is in his house and ready to be his best friend.
Yeah, I can see that.
Which I think is a sweet concept, you know, uh-huh. Especially if you feel that way as a young man. I felt somewhat like that, but I did have a twin brother. Mm-hmm. I can imagine if you're an only child and you feel like that, you'd love to have just this cool, badass kid to come in, keep people from picking on you, introduce you to girls, teach you how to be a tough guy.
My younger sister very rarely won fights for me, but okay. Not as much as I'd like to.
She could take them like a champ, but she couldn't yes. dish it back out. No. All right. Peter Gallagher was actually the first cast member that was cast, and things kind of fell into place after Sandy Cohen was cast. So fun fact, Peter Gallagher was cast as Sandy Cohen. The Coens were first going to be called the Needlemans. but Josh, in the interview...
Wait, no, I'm sorry, Needlemans? The Needlemans.
But Josh Schwartz, in this interview, quote, says that it was problematic because the name was too Jewy. So they had to dial that back, apparently, according to Schwartz. Gallagher was cast to be a kind of a heavy-hitting actor that could really bring some gravitas to the show with all the new young acting kids. Because he wanted this show, unlike 90210, which was very popular right before this, he wanted the show to be as much about parents and their lives as the kids and their lives. So he thought Gallagher was, not Gallagher the comedian. Peter Gallagher was a good way in to do that.
And not Black Gallagher, the Dave Chappelle character.
No, there are no Black anything on the OC. Yes. Get ready for that.
Well, I mean, I will say, like, from a first-time experience, like, watching any sort of teen drama, I'm definitely very skeptical about the acting and the quality of the characters and stuff.
Marissa?
And we'll get to that in a second. But how can you not look convincing passed out? Like, I did not buy the fact that she was...
She's all pretty.
But the opening scene of Sandy and Ryan, like, together and them, all their interactions, I mean, I think that entirely sells the show based on both of them as actors. And so... I think that was what I really came away with was is it, it's Ben McKenzie?
Ben McKenzie, yeah.
Ben McKenzie, yeah. Like the
Commissioner Gordon.
Yeah. But that, you know, just being, well, tell me more about like what he had acted in before. Had he been in much at all? Was he kind of discovered? Like,
I know he was in While You Were Sleeping, that big drama movie where I think he like hones in on a sleeping man, a man in a coma's wife, and he is that man's brother. And while he is sleeping, his wife is at the side, the bedside, and then Peter Gallagher is the one that kind of moves in on that man's wife.
Sorry, he's in a coma. Not Peter Gallagher. Ben McKenzie.
Ben McKenzie, I believe this is his first thing that he's ever done.
Wow. I was like, Ben McKenzie would have been like 14, and While You Were Sleeping, that would be so weird to pair him up with Sandra
It was a
Bullock.
Really interesting movie, but very important. It's kind of like a Harold and Maude.
Yes.
yeah, as far as I know, this is Ben McKenzie's first thing. It was at least very, very early on. I think, I know for a fact he was up for like kind of a sixth leading role on a, like a PBS show or something like that.
Gotcha.
So he was, yeah, he wasn't up for, or maybe it was a WGN. He wasn't up for, you know, he wasn't like a leading guy like he was.
Right.
Like
right. No, I'm sure. And yeah, I think I really liked a lot. And Russell, I know you've studied acting a bunch. I liked a lot of, so you weigh in on, yeah, on acting.
How is the acting of the OC?
Yes. But I liked, he did a lot of acting with just moving his eyes and not his head.
That's a nostril work for Ben McKenzie.
Yeah, he had a coach.
Notice the sucking of his nostrils. It's very prominent.
Nostril coach that came in and did 4 hours. But it was a lot of like, if someone looked at him, he would like close his eyes and open them, and his eyes would be looking at him, but his head hadn't turned. I was like,
oh yeah, he'd do that thing. Well, I'm about to illustrate it. Be like, he's yeah, very exactly. like a dramatic kind of, he does that a lot. It's both his reaction to like, I'm mad, I'm serious, and also like, you're crazy. It's like the, he uses the same kind of like head turned, cut eyes to the side.
No, mm-hmm. the party right before the fashion show is just a bunch of people coming up to him and talking to him, and he doesn't say a thing. And yet it gets the point across completely, which I probably also helps for someone whose first time being on the show is they don't have to act as much. If they're just standing there quiet,
yeah,
looking, then the less they say, the more they come off cool. And
well, I kept thinking that this was like, this type of role feels like it was designed for people like Steven Seagal or like Jean-Claude Van Damme. Like, it's like the strong, silent, brooding type is like an excuse for like an actor who probably doesn't speak English and is a bad actor, but is like trying to drive an action movie. Mm-hmm. And I think like he did such a great job with it, like shows how you can actually do that and do it well. I know he gets compared to Russell Crowe at some point.
Mainly,
but I think,
mainly his face, but yeah.
But I think of him in like LA Confidential is the same type of thing of like strong, silent type, but actually having acting and gravitas.
Well, you guys have
it.
Seen what McKenzie's done since the OC. At least he was in the Southland where he was kind of a taciturn cop.
And I watched that.
That came from a sort of privileged West Coast city, and he becomes a kind of a soft-spoken but kind of badass cop in LA. And then he moves on to Gotham, where he is a...
I didn't watch that.
I did watch
that. I don't know if I'd call him soft-spoken, but he's a stern and kind of taciturn,
yeah,
kind of bad, quietly badass commissioner now. I guess he's not commissioner. I don't actually watch the show. But I've seen a few episodes, and he's like at least
he's
a high-ranking
yet,
cop.
But he's getting a detective.
But he kind of has an archetype, I think he does, yeah.
Gotham and Southland both are Fox as well, right? Are there all three shows he's been on Fox?
I guess so. Yeah.
So, you know, the way my own personal canon for Ryan is that he grew up in the... Man from the Wrong Side of the Tracks in Chino. He's in Khaki, California. he gets raised by the Coens, and then he comes out with some privilege. Then he joins the police force in L.A. of Southland. He graduates their ranks and goes to Gotham and becomes commissioner with Batman and all that.
I like it.
Okay.
It's a thing. All right, moving on. Okay, so we've talked about Gallagher a little bit, and we've talked about Ryan a little bit, but let's talk about the original castings. I don't have too much about Marissa other than she was very young when this started, and the only thing I know that she was in before this was she was a little girl in Sixth Sense that throws up all over herself.
There we go.
Yeah, when she's underneath like a fort or something that the little kid in the Sixth Sense made, and then...
I think she was a ghost, right?
If she was a ghost that had been poisoned by her mother.
There we go.
Yeah. And so that was like the big reveal in the Sixth Sense is that the kid was going to like try to help her and by doing so help himself, because she would then disappear once he let the father of the little girl know that the mother was poisoned.
Spoiler alert for 1999.
Spoiler alert for Sixth Sense, dead people, et cetera. People are seen. Marissa was originally going to be cast as Olivia Wilde. but who is fresh from DC, a new actress so trying to get better. Some work in Hollywood. But the casting people thought that Olivia Wilde would have been a little bit too tough, a little bit too self-confident, a little bit too strong for the Marissa, and they wanted Marissa to be a little bit more doe-eyed, a little bit more fragile, a little bit more of a damsel that needs Ryan to come to her distress.
All right.
Which becomes a bit of a theme, the OC, of Ryan constantly helping the damsel.
Okay.
Possibly to a bit of a mania on his part. Like, what is his identity if it's not helping out a woman? Does he have one?
Fair enough.
Ryan was originally going to be cast as Garrett Hedlund. Are you guys familiar with him? I'm familiar with the name, but I had to look up who he was.
Yeah. Well, it's weird that he has a Columbia, because remember when Death Sentence was filmed in Columbia?
Yeah.
He was in that. And all right. So... The amount of people that I know in Columbia that have random stories about meeting Garrett Hedlund, but then I knew he was in Tron. But other than that, I haven't
heard.
He's
in Troy. He did not take this role because he went to go be in Troy.
Oof.
He looks somewhat like Ryan, same coloring, same like type of face build type of yeah. thing. Same type of guy, mm-hmm. Good looking dude. He looks a little bit older to me from the pictures I saw that time period. But yeah, McKenzie's not exactly a super young dude in this show anyway, compared to some of the other actors. Both he and Adam Brody, who plays Seth, are a little bit older. I think both Rachel Bilson and the actress that plays Marissa, who is
Misha Barton,
they're both quite young.
Okay.
But anyway, so that's Ryan. Seth got the part despite not learning any of his lines or doing the script at his audition. He's a
awesome.
He's
what a, did he do?
He's a improver guy, and he basically took the role and got basic direction for what he did in the scenes and would improv all of his own pop culture references and do that kind of thing.
All right.
So I think, I guess maybe it worked to his advantage actually trying out for the part like that.
Did he have any pop culture lines in this first episode? Other than GTA, I'm not remembering anything specific.
I wouldn't be surprised if this one was a little bit more tight with the script. Yeah. And maybe because it's the pilot and they maybe let him expand later on. Later on, definitely he kind of just goes off on pop culture rants. Let's see. Marissa's little sisters cast is Shailene Woody in this. And you guys might know Shailene Woody from Divergent and The Fault in Our Stars.
This is her as
a very young lady. Mm-hmm. She's recast later, though, by a different actress.
Oof, R.I.P.
The reasoning given by Schwartz in the interview I had read was...
Too Jewy.
That in a few years down the line... She is not. They are very waspy. A few years down the line, the sister kind of... gets out of the show a little bit, and she comes back, and she's aged a few years, and they thought that Shailene Woody was not old enough to be doing the things that they wanted the little sister to be doing when she came back onto the show. She's dating some, and she just didn't look old enough.
Gotcha.
If you actually look up the information about the actress, though, the actress they got to replace her is only 5 months older than her, so I don't know exactly. Maybe she just looked older, I don't know.
Seems like, yeah.
Or maybe Shailene Woody was making her pine deodorant and stuff like that, and they just didn't want to deal with her. Like, she's super hippie. She makes her own deodorant and
makes her own medicine. I think that was her.
Oh. Yeah. So make sure you follow her on her medical advice. Her and Jenny McCarthy have a really good podcast about how to keep yourself really healthy. Specifically, Schwartz describes this show. So that's the casting information. Schwartz describes the show himself as a Trojan horse. Okay, and what he means by that is that...
Are we Greece?
Yes, yeah, we
hidden inside of us.
Oh.
We are Troy.
Okay.
Garrett
Hedlund.
Basically what he says is he was a huge fan, and again, 26-year-old man, Josh Schwartz, he's a huge fan of Freaks and Geeks at the time, and My So-Called Life, both shows not having a long run, not being super commercially successful, but very critically successful. So he didn't want to pitch the show as a show like that.
Uh-huh.
So what he said he did was he Trojan horsed it in a show that seemed to have a lot of pretty girls and bikinis and party, expensive-looking pretty stuff, and he said he wanted to actually tell a Freaks and Geeks style show that he could kind of get on the air by presenting as a 90210 kind of clone.
That's pretty genius.
I can see that with Ryan and Seth being a mix of Franco and the weird Sam Weir.
Mm-hmm.
I can see that.
I think the example he gave was one of them was Luke Perry, and I don't know enough about 90210 to say.
He
gave examples.
Yeah, but since I don't know anything about 90210, I didn't take notes on that because I don't know. Who the Luke Perry one would be anyway.
I think the Luke Perry was the tough one. That'd be like the cool motorcycle guy. And then I'm trying to think who the nerdy one would be. Maybe like Brian Austin Green or someone.
Doesn't he date
Transformers, like, yeah, Transformers, Fox.
Megan Fox.
Yes.
Not that dorky. Mary okay. Terry. The other way that Schwartz described the series was describing its kind of overall positionality in the history of television, and that it came post 9/11, 2003, very close to that. And his concept of it as an outsider, a story of outsiders, people that are outsiders inside the community. Ryan being an outsider, let in, is he possibly dangerous? Is to orient him around Muslim Americans at the time, and the feeling that maybe certain types of Americans had towards them, as in, who are these? We are us. We are insular. There's these people that are possibly dangerous. These people are the outsiders of our community. How should we trust them? How should we feel about them? How do they feel coming into, you know, are they safe? Do they feel welcome? That type of thing. So he was trying to position the show in its time frame in that way, he said. I don't know if I picked up on that myself as I was watching it, but I could see at least somewhat tangentially that was being addressed, maybe.
Well, when you mentioned earlier the idea that everyone's an outsider, yeah, that suddenly started to click to me, and I started to think of moments where every single character, except for maybe Seth's mom, and was an outsider.
So, like, and Seth's mom was born in the OC, living in the house her dad built, working in the company her dad made. Mm-hmm. So she might be your true OC, and if you had to pick one in the first episode, at least.
But I mean, Seth, he no one likes him at all, as you see, and. Uh-huh. Like, Marissa just gets left for dead by her bud, so they're obviously not that close.
And she seems to have some sort of, like, empathy thing going on with her. Like, she's not the greatest actress in the world. People say that all the time, but I think there's something. She does have very emotive eyes as well as Ryan. I feel like she does some things where it's like, she does some quiet moments where she's like looking at him and like seeing him type of thing, mm-hmm, where she honestly has sympathy towards him and tries to get to know him, while everybody else just tries to categorize him immediately, whether it's a sex object as her best friend Summer does, mm-hmm, or whether it's even Sandy's wife Kirsten being the kind of he's from the wrong side of tracks, he's danger, Seth, yeah, he's my savior, Sandy, he's a project. Like, seems like Marissa definitely does just want to talk to him, just want to see what he's about. And also, it seems like when she first meets him, she's like, oh, you must be the cousin from Boston. But do you think she actually thinks that?
Ryan's first line is, I'm whoever you want me to be. Yeah. And so that's, she's just always looking at him, trying to figure out who she wants him to be, how she wants this to go.
Because that line, you must be the cousin from Boston, it's either they mentioned a cousin from Boston at some point, and we just didn't get to see that, or she's like giving him a cover story, like, you don't have to tell me if you don't want to, like, this is a possible cover story.
And that's a good call, because I am embarrassed to admit that I don't know if I necessarily got, when he sort of gives her, they're staying outside, and mm-hmm, he gives the entire life story in a sort of very like overconfident kind of lots of bravado of like, yeah, mm-hmm, but he was hamming it up a bit. And then at the end, when she's like, you must be the cousin, I didn't take away one way or the other whether she's like, oh, so you're just making that up and you're clearly just the cousin from Boston, or like you said, that she's saying.
Well, I definitely got an undercurrent, like there's what they're saying and there's a second level, right? And I feel like they're saying this kind of like somewhat vapid, flirty back and forth diatribe. But there's also, it seems to be like he's saying, this is what you expect out of me. I'm going to give you what you expect. You've never seen someone as tough and cool as me, so I'm going to play up that role. And she's saying, hey, let me bum a smoke. Does she normally smoke? I don't know. But like, it seems like she's playing up like, hey, I can hang with you. I'm not like these lame-os. It seems like there's definitely like two people both acting. They're both code switching, as you call it, in race relations. But they're putting on airs to try to be what the other one was maybe expecting or maybe not expecting, uh-huh, to kind of make themselves more interesting. I thought it was really interesting they both immediately jumped to that. Because you remember, Ryan is not like a big player guy. It doesn't seem like he's smooth. It doesn't seem like he seems very straightforward. That seems like a very somewhat out of character scene for him to be like, whoever you want me to be. And he like leans up against like the light post and he like raises his chin at her and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That was my note for that scene, was smoking is so cool, because he looks really awesome. Just smoking his cigarette, being all tough.
That blew me away. Like, I know it's only been 10 years ago, but seeing just smoking, like, a put teenager, in that light,
yeah,
and just like, yeah, it's cool. And then, like, I'm having this intimate moment over it. I'm already not used to seeing that on regular TV or any movie.
Oh, well, yeah.
It speaks to that outsider status, right? Like, he's not allowed to smoke in the house, and he's not allowed to smoke in the yard. He has to go out to the edge of the street where she is also at the edge of the street. They're bonding over an activity that he's not allowed to do within the confines of their living space. And she also, if you're talking about outsiders, she's literally outside the home when he sees her. He meets the mother inside the home. Marissa is positioned outside of the home itself. So she is both physically placed as an outsider, and also so I think they're definitely pushing that in a lot of ways. That theory crumbles whereas he meets Seth. He's an outsider that's inside the house, I suppose. But he has a diversion. He's playing a video game. He's escaping. It's
outside of the couch and on the floor.
Yeah, yeah. What do you think about the introduction of Seth there? It seemed a very childlike way to introduce him, right?
Do we get into the plot of it already? Do we want to back up and talk about any of the stuff leading up to that?
Good point.
Because I have lots of silly notes. Where did they get the bookcase in the prison room when he's meeting with the lawyer? Why was there a bookcase? It made me laugh.
I didn't even catch that.
I just wanted to know what books were in that they're just like, let me cite this.
Well, the Shawshank Redemption.
Yes. What's that?
Count of Monte Cristo.
Thank you. Yes. Alexander Dumbass.
The Green Mile.
Yes. And Pride and Prejudice. So the opening, first line of the series, I'm your big brother. If I don't teach you this, who will?
Sandy Cohen.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not Sandy Cohen. That's his big brother.
I mean, Sandy Cohen says who's going to teach him.
We'll teach him. That's his brother, Trey, right?
Trey, yeah. Trey is originally played by Bradley Strike in the pilot.
Okay.
Bradley Strike Logan, which is a sweet name, Bradley Strike Logan. He's played, he plays Trey in the pilot. Then he's replaced when he comes back to the show a couple seasons later by Marshall Green, who is one of the main characters from Prometheus.
Okay, that's a dude who looks just like Tom Hardy.
Yeah, he's the what you say guy.
Yeah.
That looks exactly like a skinny Tom Hardy, kind of white trash Tom Hardy.
There we go.
More white trash Tom Hardy.
We could all be so lucky.
That opening scene, yes, I don't get why there were so many cops so quickly. There was already a cop looking at they were stealing the car, and that's the only thing they did wrong. And all of a sudden, they're just completely surrounded by cops and in jail instantly. They were on a...
action packed and all that. I would say to that, I don't know if it was just this might be spoilery, whatever. The brother is, I think it's part of like, it's more than just let's steal one car. I think he's kind of involved in like a whole kind of underground car stealing chop shop type deal. So
like
it might have been a sting or
tapped on his phone and just been following him
or
around.
Or some type of sting maybe. There's like a car they put out to see if he would steal it. That might be it. Or just they want to be exciting because it's a McG show, an MKG show.
Yeah. That makes sense then, because I just was like, why are there so many cops all of a sudden? What have they been doing? Have they been following them this whole time? And I guess they are.
That's the reason. I don't know if that's actually that. I mean, it's just the pilot. They probably didn't write that yet, so
I
just wanted to action-y.
When do they... I wish I'd made a note. When do they actually come in with the opening California credits? Is this
I made a note of that, and I don't know if I brought it with me, that specific note, but it kind of builds. It builds and kind of swells as he's come home and he's realized.
Yes. He just left, right? Mm-hmm. Like his mom kicked him out.
His mom kicks him out, and he gets his ass kicked by AJ, who's had it up to here with Ryan.
Yes.
Even when Ryan's being, the mother's kicking him out, Ryan's still sticking up for his mother in that exchange, if you remember. Mm-hmm. He says, like, you're just living off my mother. And so he's being kicked out of his mother as he's still helping the damsel of a woman from her evil dragon that holds her as AJ. But she's kicked out of the house, and then he goes to the payphone to try to call everyone he knows. There's the music swelling, California. Mm-hmm. And it's swelling as he's calling everyone. He finally breaks down. He's like, I'm going to call Sandy. And then Sandy comes and picks him up, and then it's crescendo. Doing is getting bigger to the big moment.
Yeah.
And as he's driving from Chino to the OC, you get through the window as he's passing, you get farther away from the city into the prettier neighborhoods, into the nice houses. And then, it kind of hits big as he makes it back to the Sandy's house.
There we go.
How far away literally is Chino from the OC? Like, does it take 20 minutes to drive?
Later on in the show, they do drive back and forth between the two. And it seems like significant enough that's like a day trip maybe. So maybe at least an hour and a half to 2 hours.
Okay.
So if you're going, it's not just like a hop, skip, and jump and you come back for lunch, but more like you can make it there for lunch, come back for dinner. I don't know why I oriented around food and eating.
But that sounds like a lovely afternoon.
If you do know me, you know why I did that. But if you don't know me.
He's a giant banana.
Yeah. Okay, so what you guys... This, a little known fact is that I am a giant banana.
Spoiler.
What did you guys think about when Sandy and Ryan meet each other for the first time? Do you remember those situations?
I fell in love with Sandy. Like, he was immediately super self-effacing about himself as a lawyer and just like... trying to help this dude. Super confident. And that was a very cool thing to see. Like, that's like, I feel like maybe I sometimes latch on to positive male role models. It's like a cool character.
That's why he's such good friends with me.
That's exactly. And that's not bananas. That's what I saw. That was neat. I dug him in instantly.
Jamie, did you want him to be your father?
100%.
A second father. You already have a father.
Yes.
The one in heaven.
Yeah. I love you. But no.
I meant God.
I know, yeah.
I meant God.
I know.
Fuck.
For my homies.
But no, I thought both the character of Sandy Cohen, like his whole thing of him, the speech, the interaction, and then also just Peter Gallagher as an actor. And keep, because that's outside of the car chase, that's the first big acting scene. And you've got a really, the whole premise of is kind of shaky, I guess, of a public defender taking home a guy that he meets really for just like one conversation. Like, it has to be a conversation that's enough to be like,
well, let's talk about that. So what's the first thing Sandy Cohen says to him, which is I'll just answer that. It's basically are they treating you okay? Mm-hmm. Are they, you know, have they done anything to you? How are you doing? So the first thing he really, besides introducing himself, who cares, the first thing he says is are they treating you okay? So immediately he latches onto him as a father figure. He sees like a kid that can be helped. And then he goes through like his the backstory of Ryan a little bit, looking at his sheet, and he has good test grades, but he didn't apply himself. What are your plans for college?
The fact that he's like, he's got all this cool stuff about him, and he's also super smart.
Yeah, just let him be dumb.
Yeah, Riggins from Friday Night Lights, I feel, is similar to Ryan, but also when he's able to be dumb, that makes me believe him more. That part about Ryan, I don't know if it's going to come back, but that made me disbelieve his character.
Ryan is a bit of a Mary Sue in that he's a super good fighter and badass. He can hold his liquor. He's good with the ladies. He's super hot. All the girls are into him, as you saw. He's actually very smart. He's somewhat artistic.
He's the imaginary friend.
What he doesn't do, he's not very creative. He's artistic because he likes architecture and stuff, but he's not super creative. He's not super good talker. He's got some limiting aspects, but for the most part, he's that Harry Potter thing where he's always right. Like, just stop thinking he's wrong. If he thinks one way and you think another, it will be Ryan's way.
Sure.
He always has the right read on stuff. He's got this kind of unshakable sense of justice and what is right and stuff. He's a Batman somewhat figure, I suppose.
He's reading articles about Social Security and how it's going to end, so why should I do anything?
That's a good point. Let me read that out loud exactly. See what you guys react when you hear it again. Modern medicine is advancing to the point where the average human lifespan will be 100. But I read this article which said Social Security is supposed to run out by the year 2025. Which means people are going to have to stay at their jobs until they're 80. So I don't want to commit to anything too soon.
No, what, you're an idiot. If you're worried about that, just start a like IRA, start a retirement fund for yourself. There are ways around that. Don't. I get it's a glib remark.
Yeah, it's a glib. He's supposed to show his, his glibness, his humor. But for the rest of the episode, does it seem like the guy that says that is the same guy throughout the rest of the episode? No. That is weird, right?
He's super Will Hunting right there. He's Matt Damon, and the rest is just you lose that.
There was a very much a Good Will Hunting moment right there. Like, oh, is this kid like super genius? This 16-year-old talking about like this article he read? Does he seem like he's reading articles about finance and his free time? It just that scene was very strange. I mean, it's supposed to set up him as more interesting than just a, you know, I'm stealing cars, I'm cursing, you know, whatever. I think they're trying to do that. I don't know if that was the best way to do that, considering that specifically Ryan, if there's nothing else you know about Ryan, you probably know, one, he punches people, and two, he's very taciturn. Like, he does not speak much. Uh-huh. It's his thing. I mean, it's a running joke in the show how little he says. And so one of the first introductions to Ryan is a full-on monologue about, like, advanced finance. I thought that was really strange
choice. It almost felt like just shoehorning in, like, big words. Like
a writer masturbating.
When the Wizard of Oz and the Scarecrow gets his like brain and he just like says the Pythagorean theorem. And and you're like, are you just said big words, big words, big words. Great, we get it, you're smart. Yeah, it definitely felt a little weird.
I'm 14 and I am smart. Let me just say as many big words as I can in this one sentence. So if I use big words, of course that means vocabulary equals.
Indubitably.
Damn it. That's what I was going
to
say.
Shallow and pedantic, yes.
But maybe that's why there are so many books on that bookshelf.
There we go.
They knew he was coming.
I wish all of the books were just about Social Security and the future, and he was just reading it. I did laugh at the idea of like the high school rap sheet. Once again, going back to like action movies, it's like if Rambo were to sit down, they'd be like, you've got quite a history, you know, four tours of Nam and Green Berets and all this. And I like that he's just like fighting, truancy, just establishing that he's been quite a string of badass things going on.
He's that type of character. Yeah, he's that action. It's the McGee's action character he wanted for his show, but transported to this dramedy. So that's kind of our intro. That's kind of our introduction to Sandy. We've talked about the swelling of the California, here we come, song and intro, and he comes. Sandy takes him back to his place. And from there, we get to meet Sandy's wife, Kirsten Cohen, for the first time.
She played me completely. I thought, I believed it completely that she was going to be super against Ryan, but then she switches it and goes and gets the shit to stop.
But she's going
to
go hide her jewels?
Yeah.
I don't know if there's... She saved my jewels?
Yeah.
She's not Smaug. She's not Smaug, Jamie. Not Smaug. Yeah, I thought it was a good comedic moment, right? The turn, you expect her to be the ice queen, the super frigid, I'm so... This kid should not be in my house.
But then at the end of the episode, she completely switches and goes back to that. So maybe there's some truth there.
Well, the truth, I think, you know, within any joke, there's a hint of truth there. So while she does have protestations, is that the word? She protests in some way.
She's a Protestant.
I think she's
Catholic. But deep down, she is a, there's a reason Sandy married her, and you see it right there. But at the end, she is definitely protective of her child. And her child comes, the first time he ever goes out with this Ryan kid, he comes back with a black eye and drunk and. So I, you know, you get the Mama Grizzly, as Palin used to say, right? You got to protect your kid over anything else. Yeah, I feel bad for this Ryan kid, but I mean, he's not family. I got to watch out for family.
Right.
Okay, so that's where her loyalties lie, is with that.
Right. So I don't necessarily see it as a bad thing that she's somewhat resistant to him. So he goes down for the night. He goes to sleep. And the next morning, we get this, what I call the harsh light of day shot, where he walks out of the pool house. Ryan walks out of the pool house, and he's squinting in a very ridiculous manner. He has a very pronounced squint that he does there with very flared nostrils. I always laugh when I see it. And he walks out, and the sun's in his eyes, and the kind of the white glare of the sun he can't see past, and it kind of dissipates as the camera adjusts, and he sees like this infinity pool and this perfect lawn and the hills looking down into the OC, as it were, into... Newport, which is, you know, Newport Beach, what it's called.
And you realize he's hit the fucking jackpot. Like, holy shit, all he has to do is not fuck up at all, and his life is great.
Though he doesn't know about his life necessarily, because remember, there's a time frame on it to start
with. Just the weekend, right?
Until social services open on Monday morning. But ostensibly, you know, at least I got a good weekend out of it, right? As long as I don't get the sun drunk and punched in the face, I'm good to go.
Can we take this moment to talk about that thing on his neck? That
the choker.
That insane necklace? Like, who is wearing that and why are they wearing that?
2003, man.
Yeah, we need someone that was more fashionable in 2003 than I was to tell me if that was a thing in the early 2000s.
Maybe my Adam's apple is a bit more pronounced, but I feel like every time I would just take a swallow or a breath of air, it would just go under and over and choke me. And
He's got the tight wife beater, he's got the tight choker, and he's got the tight archer's brace on the leather archer's brace on his wrist. Like he's got these maybe representative of some sort of shackles, maybe once he gets freed a little bit in the OC, he loses some of these very restrictive garments he's wearing.
Loosens his choker a bit. Well, I will say, and
to deep read it a little bit.
We haven't talked about him yet. He's my favorite character of Marissa's boyfriend. Also had the like the super tight like white shell necklace. Like, just I love, because once again,
he's a white hat, Ryan's the black hat.
It's a yes.
Right.
So you're doing a pilot, you're painting in broad strokes, you need to give her a terrible boyfriend to work against. And they stack the deck so amazingly. It was like giant truck, loud music, opens the door, get in.
Foreshadowing with the music, the music in the car he's listening to is hypersexual. And then the main conflict with Luke comes when, one of the main conflicts with Luke comes, both of his sexual attacks upon Seth, calling him a queer and things like that. Mm-hmm. And then also the digression... the transgression he has against Marissa, where he goes and cheats on her at the beach. I feel like they're thinking about those things. So he rolls up, let's have hypersexual music blaring out of his truck.
I was hoping the band was called Hypersexual. I was like, has anyone used that yet?
No, I was going to write down the lyrics, but it's just your typical, I mean, it's typical kind of like
puddle of mud type of thing.
Well, I think it was rap. It was very objectifying. It's like saying, hey, bounce like this, that type of thing.
Sure. Well, that is to say, he had the same necklace.
But that was good bouncing you did. I'm sorry that the podcast listeners cannot see that.
Bouncy banana.
I'm a bouncy banana.
That opening when Seth first meets Luke, and he's like, hey, or that's not the first time, they obviously know each other, but he's just like, hey, dude, and the guy just says, suck it, queer. Like, instantly, like, who is going to be that mean
would
to
that
someone
have been,
for any reason?
Would it have been better for him to kick a puppy, or was that the best?
Like,
to throw out a,
you know what
a,
I'm saying?
A sexual slur, like, homosexual slur for no reason, no possible reason there.
Abusive, aggressive, homophobic, and then, totally, like, objectifying that super tiny girl pigtails. And it was awesome. They could not make him any more of a villain.
And what do you think about the bullying right there? Like, did you buy that he would talk to him like that? In your experiences, super cool guys that would pick on nerds when you guys were younger in high school. Did that make sense that he would... Why do you think he's bullying Seth so far? Where does that come from?
I couldn't tell. It came from nowhere. It was like, what? Why? What did Seth do?
Seems very extreme.
I will say the only thing I could... Because usually what they do with bullying is it just like comes out of nowhere. It's the middle of school. This specifically, I guess, is a party that he was not invited to. So that's the only thing.
Ryan was invited, yeah.
And then he brought him with him, you know, like.
Okay. I'm thinking earlier at the fashion show.
That's when he says suck it queer. Yeah. This is before he even gets beat up at the.
Right. No, that was just, I guess, to establish that he's a terrible person. And that felt so over the top for what it needed to be. But no, the bullying later at the beach.
I feel like that's a thing in television and movies. You see like a representation of bullying, and maybe this is how bullying is sometimes, but there doesn't seem to be any reason for it other than weaken the herd, right? I see this guy that's different than me. I'm going to make him feel bad about himself. The one thing I could see Seth being, maybe you don't see much of it in the premiere, but you see it later. He's a bit of a pretentious ass, and he knows he's smarter than a lot of people, and he knows he's better than these like troglodyte Oceans. Well, yeah. So I could see him kind of carrying himself like that and having Luke be a little bit like, thinks he's fucking better than us. He doesn't want to play water polo. All he likes is reading his On the Road by Kerouac, which is his favorite book.
I can see some of that shittiness jumping ahead, but when he eventually sees Ryan with Summer and he's like, "You're Chino," and stuff, I was just like, get the fuck over yourself, Seth.
A lot of people like Seth. Seth, for me, is very selfish. He's very misogynist in a lot of ways. He has a lot of like territorial issues with the women in his life.
How are you going to name a boat after a girl you have never spoken to? Boat away.
Not to jump too far ahead, but we're about right there. Creepy or not creepy? Creepy or romantic? Naming your boat the Summer Breeze to a girl you've never talked to before.
100
insane.
Creepy. 100% creepy. Ugh, that's just.
What do you think the reaction was of the target demographic when they saw that? Ooh, I wish somebody would name a boat after me, or ooh, this guy should move away from this town into a prison.
Exactly. Bury him in the ground.
Did you guys notice? Because I didn't. What did Ryan have a reaction to Summer Breeze at that point?
I felt like he played it very nicely. He was just like, "Yeah, okay, whatever." He didn't shoot him down. Mm-hmm. Which is probably what he should have done.
Someone needs to tell
straight
him
to him, but
just rub his face in it.
I was like, "Yeah, it's okay, whatever," but didn't.
In the same way that he handles him like an older brother of like, I need to show you why this is wrong. The same way like, yeah, we need to come to this party. Yeah, you need to talk to girls. And the same way like, yeah, you shouldn't be naming boats after ladies you don't even actually have a talking relationship with, as far as I understand.
Does she know he even exists? Because at one part in the party, he shows up and he says something when she's hitting on Ryan. She's like, who are you?
Right.
So I don't even know if she knows he exists.
Yeah.
As a person that lives.
I don't know much about Dawson's Creek, but I feel like a major part of that is that Pacey, the Joshua Jackson Mighty Ducks kid, has a boat and he's going sailing at some point, or like that's his big dream is to go sailing. Is that familiar? Is that a real thing? Cause that felt very similar to that. It just seemed very much ripped from a show before that, I guess.
When was Dawson's Creek on?
90210 time, right?
Yeah, it was after that. So like 90210 would have been early 90s until late. It was on for probably 9 or 10 years. And then Dawson's Creek was probably mid 90s into the early 2000s. So I think it was before this, maybe the in between time, between 90210 and the OC.
You are probably right. My frame of reference for this trope is definitely the OC because it's his big thing. But it might have been done before. I don't know.
So you always have to have a boat. Any teen drama, you got to have the boat character.
If you're talking about Outsider, and that speaks to like his need to like leave the confines of this place he doesn't feel a part of. It's always this, you know, this the old quote: every man sees his own future in tall ships on the horizon. You know, the expectation of this can go somewhere and I can go with it.
I did kind of laugh at the part just before that where they said, "So what do you do for fun around here?" And then it's just boating montage.
It's not like a super exciting speedboat. It's just it has like a pretty little song that interjects and just like it's cutting through the waves. But it's not like a speedboat. It's not a yacht. It's a tiny little.
It's just it's lovely, a dinghy. Gentle afternoon spent
on the summer breeze.
Mm-hmm.
Probably by himself. No one else is going out there with him. He's just him and his thoughts about summer.
Is that the first other person that's ever been on that boat besides Seth?
Yes.
Besides Captain Oates. You guys don't get Captain Oates yet. A couple other things that just showed up around this same p- part, p- part of the episode. You see a side plot beginning with the next door neighbor, Marissa Cooper. Her father has some sort of issue with men in suits appearing at the door and handing them business cards.
Yeah, what was it? The U.S. Security and Exchange. The
Exchange Commission, yeah. And then we've also got at the fashion show, when they go to the fashion show where Luke tells Seth to suck it queer. You've got Ryan, the first instance of what I call Ryan see things that other people don't. So Ryan sees Marissa's father break down and cry in the bathroom. That's the first instance in this episode of Ryan seeing something that the rest of the OC happened to miss out on.
We also learned that he has super strength because he just ripped that toilet paper roll thing off the stall wall. Like
barely touched it and it just disintegrated it.
Rumbled.
You gotta make sure if your props that doesn't like stick on you, man. You gotta reshoot that over and over again.
The fashion show, I thought it was gonna be something different. When they said that this was Marissa's fashion show, I thought it was gonna be clothes that she designed and not just popular designers that were being worn by students. That was an insane concept. It's just, what were they giving fashion? They were just walking around in dresses for...
Yeah, it was showing the privilege, first of all, for like a tactic for the show, but I think it was also, it's like a frame that you're seeing for almost every OC episode. There's some sort of charity event or there's some sort of like big party being planned, and that's going to be like the central point of a lot of shows. I think in the next episode, it's cotillion, things like that. So, and this one, I think that was a charity event where you paid to go to this fashion show. Maybe you bought the clothes from charity too. Maybe this is out of their own wardrobes that they're modeling and then selling the clothes, maybe.
Although, did you guys at your high school do prom fashion show? I think that was like a thing that they just sold. It basically was an excuse for everyone to walk up and down in the auditorium wearing their like prom outfits.
I would have done that if I could have, because I had a white skin tight tux and a baby blue ruffled shirt.
That's what you're wearing right now.
I wanted attention in high school real bad and Converse Chuck Taylors. But no, I don't think Rusty, you know,
No, theirs was not that.
I mean, it was like the chino version of what they did at the OC, where it was just, you know, low rent and just an excuse really just to raise money, I think, for the prom. But I guess there's precedent there for doing it, not using, or the names they were throwing around. The one girl couldn't wear the dress because her boobs weren't big enough.
Vera Wang, which I don't know enough about Vera Wang to know why that's a thing.
Yeah, I believe it's just high end is the reason.
Mm-hmm. But so
you have to have titties.
She had to wear Calvin Klein instead, right? Yes. I think that was it. So yeah, everyone knows Vera Wang, big boobs.
And Calvin Klein's like such a letdown because Vera Wang's the good one. Calvin Klein's the gross one.
Right.
Unless you're Marty McFly's mother, in which case Calvin Klein, amazing.
Yes.
On his underwear.
But that's creepy.
Yes. Super creepy movie, guys.
That first thing Summer was wearing, I have no fucking clue what that dress was. When she came out on that, I was like, Marissa has no talent designing dresses then. The fact that that's, I guess, a real thing and probably great fashion blows my mind.
I don't remember what the dress was, but I remember her movement was really cute. Like, it was really not cute in an attractive way necessarily, though it wasn't bad, but it's just like, it's just lots of frenetic movement. And she seemed like really excited to be there, like posing like a kind of like a teenage girl might think you should pose as a model. I thought it had a lot of energy to it. She just jerky, moving around, super
smiling.
That
makes sense because if you picture a mismatched pattern of pink, blue, and white lightning bolts all over each other, then that's the type of energy you saw.
It's avant-garde, yes.
I've never seen Rachel Bilson look unattractive except right then. It was the weirdest thing. Oh, the blue, like, eye shadow.
Oh, God, her makeup was insane.
It looked like...
And then they cut to backstage where someone was saying, don't put too much makeup on them. And I was like, well, you missed the first person of the fashion show.
You learned from
your
mistakes.
I thought all the young ladies looked lovely.
I thought those young ladies in the show are garbage.
They were a vision.
She looked like a bad guy from Batman and Robin.
And I was rock hard for those high school girls.
When are you not?
All right, so what happens? We talked at the, right now, for example, at the fashion show, we have the breakdown in the bathroom of Jimmy, where Ryan gets to see it.
Is that Marissa's dad's name is Jimmy?
Yeah, Jimmy Jimmy Cooper is his name.
Jimmy Cooper. Yeah, when they called Marissa Coop, all I could think about was Wet Hot American Summer, and I was like, she should not be called Coop. She is not Paul Rudd's character at all. They need to save that for someone else.
We shorten a lot of names in the see. Summer is called Some, very awkwardly, by Marissa. Marissa Cooper's called Coop by Summer. Seth is just Seth, and Ryan gets called Rye by his mother and his brother. And Rye sounds really weird when they say it to him. Come on, Rye. It's always kind of like that.
Come on, Rye, you said in the bakery.
the most delicious type of sandwich.
I wish Come on, Summer Rye. And Cooper were just Murr and Purr. That
Come on, Rylene.
Rissa.
Come on, Shailene. Woody. Nope. What else happens at the fashion show? Oh, yeah, we get towards my hypothesis that Luke is the actual hero of the show.
Wait, what?
He's a bit problematic with his problematic. Homophobia and his bullying, but I can overlook that. He's got a sweet truck, and he's got good hair. He's a good-looking dude.
Oh, yeah.
He's a bad guy, yeah. But, I mean, think about his mindset for that party when, at the fashion show, he's watching his beautiful girlfriend parade down. It's her day, and when she gets to the end of the catwalk, she cuts eyes directly at Ryan and does not look at Luke, and then he follows her eye path towards Ryan, and she's known the guy a minute, and she's giving him the sexy eyes at the end of the catwalk, so he is rightfully feeling somewhat threatened, I guess. Maybe he doesn't react in the best way. Maybe he's a bit territorial about the whole thing.
So you're saying his girlfriend looks at another guy, and so it's up to him now to destroy that relationship and do whatever he wants, and anything he does is now justified because her eyes looked at a new guy.
100%. Well, when you say it out loud,
that's all
it
fair.
It sounds not what I was thinking in my head, but I'm saying that.
I don't even think he could tell from his position where she was looking. She just stopped at the end of the catwalk like models do.
Every time he turns around this episode, it's her eyes and Ryan's eyes right there. Mm-hmm. Like when he rolls up with his monster truck, blaring his sexually aggressive music, it's Ryan and Marissa. When he's at this fashion show to support her, this new guy that he saw earlier that he doesn't know his deal, it's her looking at him again. I'm not saying he's necessarily justified. It's somewhat of a joke saying he's the hero of the show. I think that's kind of their mindset for him, both cheating on Marissa at the party and starting a fight.
Bit of a Christ-like figure. I mean, we can all agree that he's definitely the most Christ-like.
No, he's not the Jewish one. Cohen is.
Fair enough. Well, okay, wait. We can stay at the fashion show in 1 second. But
it's pretty much done.
When it goes to the party and Luke goes up to the girl with pigtails and says, you know, we're going to go walk out to the beach. It doesn't matter. Is that specifically because he's trying to make her jealous, or is that just to sort of show that he does this all of the time?
I think it's to show the casualness at which he will cheat on Marissa.
Okay, got it.
Plus, he knows that I guess she's going to get super blackout drunk and her friends are going to drop her off at their house. So, you know, he's going to go and have fun on his own. Why weren't they hanging out at the party? And why were Seth and Ryan not hanging out at the party? They'd get to that party and immediately leave each other's company. Like, mm-hmm. What are you going to do?
And Summer mentions that when she drops Marissa off at the end of the episode, she says, shouldn't your boyfriend be doing this? Ha ha ha. So it's establishing patterns all over the place there. It's the pattern that Luke doesn't expect her to be around him, the pattern that Luke is comfortable doing this, the pattern that Marissa tends to be a blackout drunk somewhat problematically. Also, when he takes off, I believe her name is Holly. I can look it up. I think when he takes the pigtail girl Holly off to get biblical on the sands of Newport Beach.
Communion.
Do you notice who's the person that notices him doing that when no one else sees it?
Right.
Ryan. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. He sees what no one else can see because he's an outsider. So they go to this wild, coked up party. Yeah. And did you notice that Ryan kind of seems in his element for the first time? Kind of smiles for the first time. Didn't see he's nervous for a second.
He says, welcome to the real dark side.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like, he's like, oh, this is my element now. People doing coke and drinking.
Yeah.
I feel like you were seeing him more of his element there, yeah.
I really liked that they kept on their suits to go to the party. I feel like everyone else was comfortable changing after the fashion show, but I thought it made them look really cool and just added a cool look to it.
I said that as well, but if you kind of look, there's some people at the party that obviously weren't at the fashion show, but Luke, it doesn't look like he's in a suit, but if you look, it looks kind of maybe it was the shirt underneath the suit.
Okay.
So it's like it's still the shirt and pants, but he took the suit jacket off. And I was thinking about that as well. Mm-hmm. Why are these the only two guys? Everyone went the same thing. But I feel like some of the people party on the beach, and like the stoners that were passed out at the bong table. Is that what you call it, Russell?
Yeah, the table.
What do you call
bongs.
Your? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I feel like those probably didn't go to the fashion show.
The bing bong table.
But like Luke and his cronies and his gang of hyenas on the beach, they were wearing like unbuttoned dress shirts and stuff like that.
Speaking of the buttoned dress shirts, how are you going to be in the 98th percentile of smart kids and not know how to tie a tie? How is he that dumb?
It's highlighting that lack of father figure. He's smart, but he doesn't apply himself. So yeah, he tests, but he's never actually had to dress up for anything in his life. He's never had to go to any function that would require that before.
I was playing teen show party bingo, and I think fat loud guy in a Hawaiian shirt was the best. That's the winning tile. Does that guy show up ever again? Is he a regular in the show? Or is that
Oliver?
I don't even remember seeing that guy.
He was the keg broke, and then Seth goes to fix the keg, and the fat dude has been passed out, and he's got marker all over his face.
Oh, got a marker on his face. That's yes. Him now. No, I don't think he's recurring. Actually, a lot in this pilot, I feel like there's a lot of little characters that might seem like they might be recurring. Like, oh, that might be a villain, or that might be a girl that shows up a lot, villain or not. I feel like. Yeah, there's just a lot of background for that party. You don't really see too many of them. I mean, Luke shows up again. Summer was supposed to be a guest spot. She was originally going to be a guest spot for this episode, Summer, but she turns out being one of the regulars.
She's horrible in this, just as a person. She's a good actress, but yep.
She's not likable at all. She hits on Ryan at the party. Granted, that's not on her at all. Seth has this obsession with her, so she shouldn't feel bad about hitting on Ryan, the hot guy, though her complete 180. I didn't have to think about it. 180. When she learns that he's from Chino, and I love her reaction, cracks me up with just ew, which is kind of her tagline is ew in the show. Her 180 on Ryan when she learns he's from Chino, that certainly does not make you like her at all.
Sure.
But she does take care of Marissa to some extent. However, she does just leave her outside on the lawn, which is, again, it might be pilot stuff because her character probably would not do that in the rest of the season. Whoa. Or the rest of the show, but in this pilot at least, unless she maybe changes by, you know, having men change her to be a better person or something like that. She seems like she's way more devoted to Marissa, where she wouldn't just leave her, on the grass.
Yeah, that was that felt weird, just because I know from like looking at artwork and trying to find pictures that I can Photoshop our faces on for OC artwork. I know Rachel Bilson kind of becomes like one of like the four core characters, and so for that to be introduced with her being like, whatever, she's passed out, I'm gonna leave her on the sidewalk and just leave.
I was like, giggling.
Yeah, fuck you.
She noticed like somewhat. I don't want to call it prescient, but somewhat like a predictive scene of it's a quick shot of four girls all standing on the patio during the party, and all four of them are on these big cell phones.
Yes.
And now you look at that, you're like, okay, that's just what a party looks like, right? But I think it was supposed to be like, look how vapid these teenagers are, all these four girls just all on their phones at the same time. I wonder if that stands out like it would have when it first came on, of like, oh, they're at a party and they're just all on their phones, not even paying attention.
You know? Which is kind of weird to think back to 2003. You don't think that much has changed in between, but definitely there's those certain things that stick out a lot. Cell phones being one of them. That's weird. There weren't iPhones then.
Yeah, what you're going to see in the OC is not a lot of just people always on their cell phones texting, video chatting, all that kind of stuff. Which, you know, if you update that and make that show today, you have to account all these plot lines for more interconnected people.
Oh yeah, the text message overlay, which everyone loves putting on shows
ever since Sherlock. There's a fight that breaks out, so we can go ahead and talk about that pretty soon.
Oh yeah. So Seth goes down to the bonfire and meets up with some guys who just immediately start beating him up. It's insane that like he didn't even do anything. He was just like, hello. And obviously, I guess those aren't his normal friends, because as he was leaving the as he was leaving the fashion show, though, like he was talking with a group of old dudes, and he was like, thanks guys, see you guys later, or whatever, to a couple of old dudes. So I guess he does talk to people, just not the young ones. But
And he's friends with the really young kids because they set up the kids' table. I forget, he's giving sailing lessons to the one little kid.
Just stares at him. It's a good comedic beat. And you notice when he got in that fight, they picked him up as Ryan's cuts his eyes to the side, and he sees him start to get bullied. And Seth yells out as he's getting picked up, to about to get beat up, he says, hurting me would be cliche, you guys. So he's like making this, I thought that was just a really interesting thing to say to people who are about to beat you up. Like, you don't want to be a cliche, do you? I think it speaks either to the writers already trying to be referential to themselves. Like, hey, did they have a discussion where they say that'd be cliche if you got bullied on the beach? Or is it something to say about him as a character, like the type of person that would say that? Does he see the world through pop culture? Does he see the world through television and movies?
Like he's very Abed right there.
Yeah.
Very Abed, yeah, from
Community.
Commodity. But my favorite, so Ryan comes to his rescue and starts fighting. I was super worried at that moment because I didn't know how Seth was going to react. But when Seth reacts by joining back in the fight, I was like, good, good. I was waiting for that, and I was hoping that's what was going to happen. Because if at that moment Seth decided to not join in and to like walk away, I was going to be so frustrated with him. But the fact that he, he still gets his ass whooped, but the fact that he tried to fight. is what made it.
There's something about catching a beating together that I don't want that to happen to us three. I feel like that's got to build some like camaraderie there. You all catch the beating at the same time, mm-hmm. you know, and one catches it to help the other one out. I also like the comedic beat where he Seth does jump back in the fight, but when he pulls the guy off of him, he then is just like. Like, he doesn't do anything. He pulls him off. He's like, I don't know what to do next. And he just gets punched in the face. Mm-hmm. Like, he's willing to, he wants to jump in and be a part of this now. He's got this friend. He's going to help him out. But I have no clue what I'm doing. I thought it was just a funny moment.
And you hate to see him lose, but at the same time, that the camaraderie of losing a fight together, I almost feel like surpasses mm-hmm. winning a fight together. Like, both stumbling back, half drunk, both with black eyes developing. Once again, there's something about, like, the look of like the tie with the tie like undone mm-hmm. all the way and
real sexy.
Yeah. Rock hard. Yeah. I thought that was a great way to end.
Turgid. Sort of, tumescent.
Banana.
But guys being bros together.
Yeah. That's 100%. Cool that dropping everything to help someone no matter what, even if you're mad at the dude at the time. I think that's a great thing to drive.
I like also Ryan seeing it from across the entire party and just like sprinting out there essentially.
Yeah.
Just like, no, I mean, and I think it's a good writing move to orient that right after Seth calls him out for being from Chino and is angry at him. Mm-hmm. Even after all that, after a good moment when they're happy together and they're jovial, protecting him isn't such a big thing. But to show, again, it calls back to when he sticks up for his mother against his stepfather guy, AJ, even when his mother's kicking him out, even when Seth is cursing him out, he still runs to help Seth out, which for the faults that Ryan does not have, but for being the wrong side of tracks, he's a felon type of thing. They try to load on. Maybe they overdo it, these positive qualities in him, I think. I think they really want to make sure you knew he was a good guy, even if he starts by stealing a car and smoking and all these other things.
Well, he doesn't steal the car. He's just with his buddy.
An accessory.
Or his brother,
yeah. But let's talk about the kind of tagline of this episode. When Ryan gets beat up and when he gets knocked on the ground, Luke kind of... Muhammad Ali's over him, kind of stepping around after he's beat him up, and he says, "Welcome to the OC, bitch." And then what does he say after that? He says, "This is how we do it in the OC, all right, in Orange County, I believe." Which I had read that second line, it wasn't supposed to be there. It was supposed to, that fight was supposed to end with "Welcome to the OC, bitch," but they added, "This is how it's done the OC in the in Orange County," so that they could actually have a promo for the episode, so they could have him say, you know, on the commercial, "This is how it's done in Orange County,"
sure.
Without a curse word in it.
I would have loved it if that's all the ad was, just "Welcome to the OC, bitch." And then Tuesdays so great. At 8 o'clock.
Yeah. And everyone gets super excited to watch this guy who's saying this really cool line. It's like, oh yeah, let's go and watch this show. I hope he does great.
Yes.
Not realizing that. I got that. High hopes for awful. Luke.
He's a bullying, homophobic, philandering asshole.
But that moment, that fight then completely turns Seth's mom against Ryan.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess you said earlier she's protecting family, but I didn't agree with it. She's wrong. She's dumb.
Yeah, because, I mean, if you think about it, everything that happened was really Seth. I mean, he wouldn't have gone to the party at all if it wasn't for Ryan, but Seth is the one that got too drunk. He's the one that called out Ryan that was territorial over summer where he shouldn't have been. That, granted, he didn't cause the fight, but it wasn't like Ryan fought and got him involved. It was definitely Ryan, like, oh, mother, Kirsten, you don't even know that he would have been beat up way worse if it wasn't for Ryan.
Mm-hmm. Well, he wouldn't have even gone to the fashion show if it weren't for Ryan. Ryan convinced him to leave the house. Mm-hmm.
So, in a sense, yeah, if Ryan wasn't here, another stuff would happen to your son, but he's also starting to live his life, which he's been in a state of arrested development, also about the OC. He's been in a state of arrested development, not been living his life, being a part, being an outsider, more so than he needs to be. Mm-hmm. And Ryan's forcing him, somewhat ironically, by an outsider is forcing him to become more inclusive in his society.
I don't have a transition here, but when the mom is saying all that stuff, she mentions that she fell in love with Sandy when he was, I guess, kind of like Ryan, mm-hmm. but also like she said that she smelled like patchouli back then, and also they lived in the back of a mail truck.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I didn't understand that. Why did they? What does that mean? Like who lives in the back of a mail truck?
Would you like me to explain it a little
packages.
Bit?
Packages.
Yes.
They went to USC together, or Berkeley. They went to Berkeley together. And
oh, UCB.
They went to Berkeley. And Sandy was kind of a hippie, passing out flyers. He was a protester type of guy. And she was kind of a stuffy, comes from OC, Republican. and they fell in love, and he lived out of his an old converted mail truck. And so when they started dating and got serious, she moved in the mail truck with them, and they would, I guess, probably smoke pot and live in this mail truck and
but
go to
classes.
But they
just tossed that in there like, oh, yeah, you know, in the back of a mail truck, like it's some euphemism for something I should understand.
I guess it's just supposed to say she was, at one point, she was down to, like, they were both free spirits type of thing, maybe.
And I guess I kind of took that as, yeah, thinking... A, sort of a converted RV.
So they get home and they go to sleep. He kind of puts Seth to bed in his pool house, right? And Seth, how would you categorize Seth's emotional state at that point? What's his reaction to the whole night?
He fucking loved it, right?
Yeah.
He was
right?
Like, oh, that was a little night we had there. He was glad and happy that he went out, which is not what he would have said earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he got his ass beat, but he was happy that just something had happened. Mm-hmm. It's like when it's why people... obsessed about like what I would do in the zombie apocalypse or something like that. You just want something to fucking happen to break the monotony. And I feel like that's very much, he feels very bored and unchallenged. And so he also, I thought was interesting. I thought he was gonna be devastated. And I didn't remember this from watching it years ago. His reaction to triumphant failure with Summer.
Yeah.
But his reaction is just like, it's not exactly how I would like to talk to her for the first time, but she knows who I am now. Mm-hmm. Like I thought it says a lot about the character. That's his reaction to that whole thing. It's somewhat of a juvenile reaction, but it's also, optimistic, and which is you see a lot of kind of negativity from him early on, so it gives you something to latch onto, I think.
So even if the mom doesn't see it, it at least drives home to the audience why they are a good pairing, why they're good for one another, and I guess more so why Ryan is good for Seth. That it feels like it's a good pairing, and so by the end of that, by the time they wake up the next day, the audience should be on board and be like, okay, I want to see this happen. Ryan needs to move to the OC. They need to be best friends. Let's see this happen.
But they have another visitor in the pool house that night as well.
Oh, yes.
What do you guys think of Marissa being dropped? We already talked about Marissa being dropped off blackout by her friends and left in the front yard. Ryan comes and tries to open the door to bring her in. He doesn't knock on the door because I don't want to get her in trouble with the mother, I suppose, Julie Cooper. So he takes her back to his pool house. So my question, similar to the question about the summer breeze, the boat, creepy romantic that he picks her up like Madonna and Child and carries her to his bedroom.
Well, he tried to get her into her house, but couldn't. I think it would have been super creepy if I was worried like he was going to start trying to make out with her and she'd wake up and they'd make out. And I was like, that's not right. But no, it was fine. It was good. It may have rained, so.
Yeah.
And she was gone in the morning anyway.
I feel like if they had no prior relationship, then it could almost just be like, ring the doorbell and walk away. Yeah. But he also was kind of vested in like not wanting her to get in trouble. So I guess I could see where on some levels it might be creepy. But I think that for the circumstances and the fact they'd be like slept across the room.
I know this is a ridiculous question asked of the OC, but melodramatic or not, with the music and the slow motion walk with the girl in the arms, because I know it's a melodrama, it's a genre almost, but I feel like that scene always sticks out to me as a little bit cringy when he's with that very classic Madonna and Child pose of her whole 6 foot tall frame, and I always think that seems so melodramatic.
That pose just reads to me as Batman holding dead Superman though. Okay. So
Daredevil and Electro.
Which
is all referencing Madonna and Child, right? Is that what that statue's called? Do you guys know?
No.
It's Michelangelo.
Donatello.
Statue. It's a giant Mary and a tiny little Jesus.
All right.
Which is the name of the episode. Tiny little Jesus. Also some of a, not to spoil too much, it's a bit of a foreshadowy moment that relation of him carrying her like that shows up.
She becomes paralyzed.
Ooh, does she carry him? That's what I hope.
Yes, Marissa's super strong. Can't you tell? She's very.
She inherited very it from her father. Person.
Yeah, she get it from her daddy. No,
she get it from her.
No,
I thought you were gonna keep going.
No, I stopped.
I think it's insane how Ryan can make breakfast in 5 minutes. His Seth's mom woke them all up, and then 5 minutes later, he's got pancakes made, bacon made, and that. That was very quick.
Yeah, he's good.
As a man who cooks a lot, I know you, it's good. I didn't pick up on that at all. Thematically, it's interesting. He talks about the reason he knows how to cook is because his mother is not so much of a cook right now.
Get it from us.
Without spoiling too much, again, the mother does come into the show again, and when she's starting to become maybe somewhat of a little bit of a better mother, her job specifically is a cook. So it's kind of like this running thing of bad mother is bad cook. It seems a little bit gender role-y.
Wait, so the Coens hire her to be their maid and a cook for them? That's insane.
That is not what they do.
Oh, it's the Bartons or the Coopers.
Yeah, so
Needlemans.
The Needlemans. So, okay.
Ned Needleman.
So the mother doesn't seem to have a great reaction. Kirsten doesn't seem to have a great reaction to their fight. Thinks of Ryan being a bad influence, gets her baby beat up. What do you guys think of the reaction from Sandy when he's told by Kirsten that they were in a fight last night? Did you guys notice his reaction?
Oh, yeah, he was real excited. Yeah. That was kind of awesome. And I was actually kind of expecting, I guess if it was just a movie and not a pilot to a TV show, probably both parents would have been excited that their son was out doing something and was hanging out with friends and has made a new friend and is just out being a teenager.
Instead of riding around by himself on a boat named after a girl he's never talked to.
Exactly. Yeah, they need to teach that boy better. He's doing some fucked up shit.
Sandy also mentioned the salting his game line from earlier, which is a line I love. I'm not even sure what it means, okay. But...
Let's make some guesses. What could salting his game mean? Obviously, it means...
Assaulting it.
It's assaulting his game. Cutting you off the knees. It's using a metaphor to describe
it. Let me... Because I forget. The first time it's happened, it's when he sees Summer across the party. And he's like, look at her, but don't look at her. Look at... And then Sandy walks up and he's like, there. And he's pointing right at her. He's like, oh, is that her? Like, Isn't that her? And so that's when he first says, quit salting his game, right? Okay, yes. And then later he says it to his mom. So, yeah, it's got it, you know, you got your game, and then you're putting salt in it. Your game is a slug, and if you toss salt in it, it shrivels up.
Because I was thinking salting is like clearing up snow or making food more delicious.
Yeah, so it's like if you're eating this food, you can put salt on it because you know your taste. But if someone else is putting salt on it for you, they're not going to know your taste, and so they're going to ruin it.
Like it's something a cook might do to fuck with their patrons or something. Like I'm going to put too much salt on it.
Wait, why would a cook do that? They would lose their patrons. Well, and then
if you're specifically trying to ruin it, the equivalent of putting a booger in their food or
when Ryan's mother returned
or something.
I wish they said quit putting a booger in his food instead.
Stop jerking off in my Tomka guy. That's Ty.
We get it.
Specificity. It's funny, right?
Yes.
That's what I hear. Okay, so then Kirsten Cohen, mother's word goes, mommy ain't happy, nobody's happy. So Ryan has to go. And he pulls off in the same car he drove up in. He's pulling out of the cul-de-sac or whatever that part of the street is. Mm-hmm. And Marissa's standing on the side on the sidewalk again for no reason. As they drive away, Luke pulls up in his black car. Not to close read too much here, but I thought it was interesting that she seems to have the setting sun behind her, or I guess the rising sun because it's the morning, right? And so there's like, it's almost like light is emanating from her, and you've got Luke in his black SUV sort of eclipses her and the light, and cuts down a little bit, and now she is obscured behind Luke in his car, and then kind of Ryan pulls away as she's being eclipsed. I thought it was just an interesting shot as well done. In my opinion.
I also like that other than planning fashion shows, apparently she spends all of her time standing in her driveway waiting for her dumb boyfriend her awesome boyfriend to pick her up.
I will say, get ready for Marissa just being outside, standing, doing nothing, looking out at things. when she finds this lifeguard station at the beach, she really comes in her own in that activity.
Okay.
She likes to sit up there alone for hours and hours just staring at the waves. Somewhat like Seth's Tall Ships on the Horizon, his Summer Breeze is a way to get out. I think that's her contemplating what if I was out of here.
All right.
And then they go back to the house where Ryan's family has been raptured and everyone's gone.
Yes.
And
yeah, so Ryan's family's gone. Sandy kind of follows him in, and I thought in a very likable move, Sandy didn't even have to really think about it. He takes it and he says, come on, you're coming home with me. Yeah. Which is such a nice, he didn't have to be like, oh, I have to call Kirsten for, no, he's just like, no, obviously you're coming home with me.
Yeah.
How much would that have changed your opinion of Sandy if like he came in and was like, oh, looks like you don't got much furniture here. Well, have a good life later.
That's how the other half lives, huh? Okay. Yikes.
Empty house you got here. Oi.
Oi, oi, oi. And
he just loosens his tie and steps
just
out.
Just like backs out.
Sure is a lot of salt in your game.
Credits.
There's no salt in your cupboards, though. Oh. Because you're poor.
Your mom
left. That's the ending, right? Like, that is the ending. He says, come back with me. And you assume he's coming back to his house.
Right, and take him to jail or anything.
Yeah. Where else would they be going? To some hotel room?
Is he gonna put them you don't see them come home, is what I'm saying. It's just kind of like, we get back to Chino, you're not going to stay here, or at least in this house.
Yeah.
Come back to my car, and that's kind of the end of it. What do you guys think of that as an ending point for a first episode? Does it make you want to see what happens with that? How's that work as a ending point?
Yeah, I was definitely interested in, like, wait, well, where is he going to go? She doesn't want him there. He's got to go somewhere.
And it's almost like, I feel like, you could have, you could have maybe had one extra scene of, you know, like pulling back up to the house and the mom with her hands on her hips, like, here we go again or whatever. But I like that they cut it right then, in the sense where I was like, I want to start the next episode. Like, and I mean, it got me interested. So I like that they cut it to exactly like they didn't add any extra fluff at the end of just like, nope, you're coming back with me. Show starts.
And that was sort of my question for, what do you think, Kirsten Cohen, the mother, what do you think her reaction is going to be at all this? When he brings him back, what's going
to
happen?
She's going to run to Jimmy's arms and they're going to start an affair.
Oh, that's a good looking couple. Finally. Jamie.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think that's, she's going to begrudgingly accept it. It's got to be.
All right. How about Seth and Marissa? What kind of reaction they're going to have?
Seth will love it.
Oh, yeah.
And Marissa.
Marissa's going to make cardboard faces of excitement.
Is there a romance already blossoming with Marissa and Ryan? Or is it just she's empathetic and she's nice to the guy? I mean, and Luke's being an asshole.
I feel like it's pretty well telegraphed that that's at least sure. Where the show's going to be going. I guess in terms of it having to be a believable thing that's going to happen, I guess they got us far enough along of giving them enough interaction where it doesn't just feel like, well, they're the attractive lead, so they should get together. So I'll buy it. It's a little loose, but
everyone's pretty attractive in this show, to be honest. Everyone could hook up with everybody.
Exactly.
Ooh, yeah, what Seth and his mother,
I'm waiting for it. Episode 69.
That's not an episode.
They're probably episode 69.
My reaction, though, was I enjoyed this way more than I thought I was going to. I didn't think I was really going to be into it at all, but there was enough there for me to enjoy and like, and so hopefully it doesn't lose it.
I really liked your point about the Trojan horse. I guess it was Schwartz's point, but that...
I cannot take credit for that.
Yeah, but I think that that's very accurate, that you go into it thinking it's going to be a very vapid, a 90210 type of just everyone being pretty and having silly problems, and probably to an extent that's what's going to happen.
It has its moments.
But I mean, to an extent, you know, Freaks and Geeks is also a little melodramatic. It's that getting an actual heart and characters that you care about. And
I feel one thing they did not push enough that would have helped it out. I mean, I'm sure it did fine. It was very, very popular. One thing that would have helped out with some, maybe the crowd that didn't check in, was letting you know that it's about outsiders. It's about a guy outside kind of judging this place and acclimating to it, not feeling a part of it. It's about a father figure in Sandy Cohen that came from New York, and he's a liberal and he doesn't make a lot of money. It's a reverse gender tropes there with he and his wife, and he's like fighting the good fight. He's a public defender, and it's this nerdy kid that doesn't feel like he belongs. And it's Marissa, who's into punk music. She, later on, she has an Against Me poster on her wall, and she is just super into punk music. And I don't know if you buy that the way the actress delivers the name of the band she likes, but in any case, she's supposed to be a little bit, she's almost like the Gilded Cage type of thing. Like, she's playing the part she's supposed to be. She's like social chair. She does these fundraisers, but really she is more of an individual than she can let on, because she has to play a certain role for her mother, for society, those type of things. If they had pushed that a little bit more, I think that would have been interesting to see who would have tuned in.
Which one would you say is Pony Boy?
Pony Boy was Seth.
Okay.
Yeah. So
Pony Boy is definitely Seth. I don't know the name of the other characters.
That's all I knew about the outsiders.
There's Ralph Macchio. If we were going to keep Tom Cruise.
Whichever one is Rob Lowe that made me feel strange things about men for the first time. So maybe Ryan in that case, yeah. So how about this question?
I like it.
Tell me if you don't understand it. what promises have been made that you want kept? Questions set up that you want answers. Like, do you know what I mean by when I say what promises have been made?
I don't want Seth to go to Tahiti. I don't want Seth to get back on that boat ever again.
You don't want Seth. Is that what you just want the boat to burn?
I would love that boat to explode and for Seth to never have to use it.
Do you
it
think
again.
Seth has jerked off in that boat?
Yes.
I think there's a fleshlight built into the back of the boat.
Where do you... Were fleshlight? Jamie, can you look up to see if fleshlights were available in 2003?
Oh, they were definitely... I don't know. I think they might have been available.
Only the Mach 1 was available.
Yes. I mean, it was good, but it wasn't as good as the one that came out in 2010.
When Seth jerks off on the summer breeze, where does he aim for when he comes?
Towards Tahiti.
Yes. Which is south. I was going to say place. On the word summer, but that's fine. So why breeze? Why summer breeze? Why not summer rain?
She farts all the time.
She's a very gassy. Breaking news on the OC Men.
Breaking wind on the OC Men.
Breaking wind on the OC Men.
It's a fart and jizz joke together. I don't know what other promises. I mean, I guess Sandy's sort of promising that he's going to help out Ryan. So that seems like it's a promise.
Okay, there you
go. But you're thinking promises like the relationships budding or that type
Basically,
of thing?
Basically, I'm kind of asking, what do you guys think are going to be the major plot points, the main problems that need to be fixed?
I imagine the whatever trouble Marissa's dad is in is going to need to be fixed. That's an issue.
Up in two separate scenes, yeah.
Mm-hmm, because that's big. And then Marissa's dad is also the one who had a previous relationship with...
Kirsten.
Yeah.
Got that whole Veronica Mars deal going.
They were sweeties in high school. Yeah, very, very similar type of thing. I would also say look for... Luke and Marissa's relationship
to get better and stronger. I can't wait for their wedding day. I hope it's beautiful.
See how that works.
Luke just takes a lot of sensitivity training, and he's just he becomes the best friend.
And so you guys had a certain reaction to Summer and Marissa, as they're not given much. The pilot is not super kind to Marissa and Summer. Summer doesn't get as much screen time because she is a guest star basically in this first episode. What do you think of her? Could you see, if you did not know, could you have guessed at all that she was going to be recurring, that she might become one of the core group?
There's a boat named after her. I felt like she was a main character. Mm.
Oh, she wasn't though. She was a guest spot to start out with. I guess it was supposed to be a throwaway though. Just like he's just a loser obsessed with this one girl in town.
Right.
And I guess they probably realized that somewhat significant if, you know, the plot lines that they actually get to know each other.
Yeah, I think if I didn't know that Rachel Bilson was then like a name that you would recognize, and I hadn't seen her in artwork for the show later, then yeah, I don't think I would have come away being like, oh, she's going to play a big role. That I would think that primarily it would just deal with the budding relationship between Ryan and Marissa.
All right. So how do you think, where do you see this whole thing going? You see it going darker, you see it going more funny? Because this is not a very funny episode. Most of the episodes are funnier than this one.
Really?
Is it going super dramatic? Is it going super comedy?
I felt it was very jovial. Like I felt like there were a lot of beats that were, it's weird that it's going to get it sillier, I guess.
There's a certain writer that makes it a lot sillier as well.
Is it?
Whenever he goes.
Josh Schwartz.
I don't know which writer it is. I have to look it up. But his certain episode, especially in the fourth season when they bring him back after it kind of got away from the silliness. Okay. He's the one that brings in like Chris Pratt and some of these comedic actors that do a good job.
I'm sorry, what? Chris Pratt shows up
early
on the show?
Early Chris Pratt, one of his first, if not his first role.
Whoa.
Is the writer Rip Torn?
It is Rip Taylor, actually.
Shablowy!
R.I.P. Rip Taylor.
Okay, so any intriguing characters that stand out? Anything like that?
Ryan, he seems pretty cool. About? I'm sorry, I'm a jerk. I don't know why I'm being a jerk right there.
That's fine. That's fine.
No, I'm trying to think of... Well, we've already established that party fat guy in a Hawaiian shirt is not coming back. That kind of kills me inside a little bit.
What about Seth's old dude friend or Seth's children friends?
Okay, you guys are watching the wrong show, I guess.
It's well, no, I'm trying to think of any other than like
all the
immediate
background
family.
Characters do not show up as main characters.
There's one of the adult ladies who starts talking to Ryan at the fashion show before the actual fashion show begins. The older one.
She's from she thinks he's from Canada.
Yes.
Yeah. She kind of comes up as almost comedy relief as a kind of cougary old lady.
She's
still hot,
that.
But I mean,
she's into against
she's
me.
Cougar. How about anything? Any favorite part or favorite line? Favorite moment stand out from this episode for you?
The salt in the game line stood out.
It was a good callback, the second time, and I think you know coming to his aid at the fight. I'd say that was probably a good like cementing shot of me being like, all right, I'm on board with this. I'm into it. I mean, honestly, I think the opening interaction between Sandy and Ryan was surprising. Like I was really, because that was probably when I was most skeptical about the show. And that really did a lot to sort of get me like, all right, well, I give the show a chance. And
the writer knew to throw in Peter Gallagher pretty early, like this a likable motherfucker.
Yeah.
Gotta give as much time to him as possible. How about this? Do you have any problems with the show? And you come out of it saying, hey, this worries me about how much I'll like it, or this is problematic, or this seems to be lame because of this, or I'm worried about this factor of it.
I don't feel like you can make any of the lady characters a hero. It's hard to get behind any of them or their actions so far. I can't root for, I don't feel like, oh yeah, no, they're awesome. I want to be like them.
Yeah, of the two parents, the cooler one's the dad. Marissa is just blackout drunk, vapid. Summer is a basic bitch, as they say.
Well, I guess there's the Amy Poehler dressing, get me my froyo mom of Marissa.
Julie Cooper is fucking amazing. Two of my, probably just right now, my two favorite characters you'll see are Luke and Julie Cooper.
Okay.
Those are my two favorite characters. They have character arcs that are amazing, and they're funny, and they're just bombastic. They just steal scenes they're in and stuff like that. So, I mean, Seth, he chews scenery. He steals a lot of scenes, but I feel like His is more on purpose. Theirs are more, they seem dynamic, in my opinion.
You ship Luli. I can get behind it. Ooh,
yes, I do. Very much. Luli all the way. And how does this hold up? Does it seem dated? I mean, it's only 2003, so it's 13 years ago. But does it seem dated? Does it hold up nowadays?
The smoking scene really stood out. But that's like just people doing a thing. So, but I didn't even catch the cell phones from earlier. So, it didn't seem too old.
Yeah, I will say that, like, you know, when you go and you sit down to watch any older show, you know, a show that is off the air, there's a part, if we were to watch 90210, there'd be a lot to cringe at in, like, production values and acting and lines and just things that felt very off. And I think maybe I was preparing for more of those, like, things being, oh, wasn't that so stupid in 2003? But I think in a lot of ways, production values were up enough that, and it's, you know, they hired a badass director and it has a budget behind it that there's not too much to sort of cringe at and be like, ooh, that's different. I mean, certainly I could see lines like, you know, her Rachel Bilson saying that she's acting retarded or like calling Thiep.
Suck it, queer.
Yeah, and like, suck it, queer, I think maybe that establishes him as a terrible character.
Yeah, okay.
But even still, I could see that, like, maybe someone
it's not like Ryan saying that when he punches Luke or something like that.
And it's funny that even this day, like, at the beginning, Trey calls Ryan. He's like, stop being a little bitch. And later when they call him a bitch, we're like, ooh, that's like problematic language. Yeah, okay. And it's very misogynistic. And like that's the type of stuff that I feel like you probably would not see on a show now. But
do I wonder if even the retard line would have gotten through if that was Marissa instead of Summer, because Summer is somewhat of a villain in this first episode, again, being a guest spot. Maybe if they knew she was going to be like this long running kind of hero character, one of the four mains once they get established. Because right now it's very much Seth and Ryan and a little bit of Sandy, and the girls are very much periphery. But there's much more of an evening out after the pilot. I say the pilot feels a little bit off tone in some ways. I feel it's not as funny. It's a little bit more melodramatic, a little bit more 90210-y. The girls are not given nearly as much agency or as made as likable. I would also say, I think it's shot differently. This might be in 48mm, and the show is, to save budget, is 18mm. Does that sound like correct numbers?
Don't think, okay. But we can.
I looked it up and I was like, I just can't remember it, but I forgot exactly what they used.
1.21
gigawatts. No, that's too much. Well, yeah, we'll have to look that up. Okay. So they probably shot this on film, though. Probably shot at 35mm, maybe.
Maybe.
So if they shot this on film, then the rest maybe digital, which is, I think, what they usually did.
Yeah, they used specifically a bigger number and then a smaller number is how they described it in the thing I read.
Okay, well, we'll look it up next episode.
I know nothing about that kind
of
stuff.
We'll talk about it.
Stay tuned.
No, I want to talk about it now when we know none of the particulars. Rusty, what numbers do you think they used?
I think one probably has to be in the 20s, but the other one can't be negative, but you said it was less than 20.
I would also think it's not negative. Yes,
I'm saying let's go negative.
Oh, I think they have to be prime numbers. Am I wrong?
Ooh, optimist.
It has to be theoretical numbers and theoretical math, right?
A little I. It's an imaginary number.
Okay. Any thoughts on the music? Anything stand out? Because they say it's a big cultural moment with this music that would come on here, get boost in sales of any band that would jump on.
Other than the theme song, the only song I recognized was All American Rejects. That's the only one I ever heard on the radio.
The swing swing from the
tree.
My heart.
Yeah, here we go.
My fart.
Which is a solid song. Maybe I don't know. It probably feels dated, I guess, at this point. But
it was big at the time, I think.
I like it.
I know the song. Phantom Planet song, they chose it. Schwartz chose it because he and his friends and the writers all thought it was a big hit. And they heard on the radio and everything. And so when they pitched the show to the producers, they're like, hey, this song is big. We got the rights to it. It'll push it. None of them ever heard it before. Apparently it was big in specific places in California, huge there, but not. Surprise. So it launched that band. It launched that that song in a big way, made an international hit.
Yeah, it's a great song, and I'm almost a little sad that probably by the end of doing all these episodes, I will be very tired of hearing that song. But that's a great choice. I like the All American Rejects. Did someone say there was a Black Eyed Peas song?
Yes, Hands Up from the Party. But it's not a Black Eyed Peas song that I knew from the radio. I don't know, it's one of their singles.
Would that be early Black Eyed Peas, probably?
I would guess. I don't know either.
I'm trying to think when. I don't think Fergie was added until maybe right around this time.
So was she a late addition to Black Eyed Peas? I didn't know that.
I think they brought her on for a song that was very popular. I shouldn't louder. Say this. And then I think she stuck in the band. But we'll look that up along with the numbers.
What
as
was
well.
She doing before the Black Eyed Peas, besides meth?
Working on her master's. She was a...
Didn't she used to do meth? It's like her thing, right?
I don't know.
I thought that's
common knowledge about her. She used to do meth.
We're putting a lot of facts on this podcast that I don't know if we can
Fergie's
back up.
Fergie's a meth head?
Yes.
I'd like to say props to Ferg for staying clean for so long. You did great.
And you quit her.
Planet Terror.
She's yeah, great yeah she Terror. Did.
I didn't even know it was her when I first watched it. All right. Anything else that we want to fit in this first show?
The associate producer was Judy Blume, and that was weird.
No way. It was, not the Judy Blume?
I don't think it was the Judy Blume, but it was. That's what it cut. As soon as he was like, no, get in the car, let's go. And then it was like, associate producer, Judith Blume.
It is a Judy Blume, not the Judy Blume.
Well, tell her that. I think she thinks she's the Judy Blume.
Dear Ryan, it's me. Seth. Is that her? Is that Judy Blume? No, that's not Judy Blume, is it?
Yeah.
Dear God, it's me, Margaret. That is Judy Blume?
Yeah.
A lot of facts.
It's interesting that Judy you put Blume Ryan as God there, but I guess he
Sandy,
is the
you're
one.
Right. Sandy would be more God.
Oh.
Luke, base God.
Hashtag yeah. Sandy is God.
Did you guys know that this episode is the only episode that doesn't start with the? It's just pilot.
Oh, interesting.
What?
See, the one, the torrent that I got said the pilot.
I purchased this episode through legal means and watched it via them.
Stole it. Come after me. Come after me, Obama.
Topical. All right. Well, I think that about calls it for the pilot episode. Is there anything else you want to say wrapping up?
I would like to say thank you guys for listening. My name is Russell, and you can follow me on Twitter at RussellManiaSC, and you can watch some sketch comedy that I do at Pasta Robot. You can find it on YouTube. It's funny. Check it out.
It's very funny. And I'm JT Timmons. I have nothing to promote. I just really like the OC. Jamie?
Yep. And it's Jamie Clark. I'm Jamie Clark, yeah, on Twitter. And
yeah, no.
And that's nothing to plug other than that. So,
except my butt.
With all that being said, ready for our big send off line?
Wait, what is our send off line?
Oh, see you later.
Nuts.
Some in music should probably go here. It should probably fade in a little bit.
Boop, 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 boop. I keep fucking around the end now because I keep thinking we're done and we're not done. I'm sorry.
I thought, Carolina, we are done.
No.
Carolina, here we come.